Hello, everyone, and welcome back. I'd like to remind you all that there is a captioning function available at the bottom of your screen. I am a man with a buzz cut, a dark beard, and glasses with a button-down shirt and a blurry background. I am joined by my child, who is an 8-month-old with a pacifier and a white dress. Hopefully, they will be an enthusiastic but quiet observer of this session. My name is August Gorman. My pronouns are he and they. I am a disabled philosopher of disability and an assistant professor at Oakland University. I am delighted to be chairing this session. This is my fourth year participating in this conference, which has for me quickly become a highlight and a mainstay of each academic year. Without much further ado, I'm very pleased to present Kristin Rodier, an associate professor of Athabasca University, presenting Encountering Fat Denigration, Spatial Allowances, and Victim Reversibility.
Thank you for that introduction. I will just start off by saying that I am not in, feeling tip top at the moment. So if there are any sudden stops, that's just bodily life. but I'm hoping that I've got an hour, a power hour for us all. I'll start off by saying I'm working on the occupied but traditional homelands of the Plains Cree, the Woodland Cree, the Beaver Cree, the Plains Ojibwe, and the Métis people in what is colonially known as Alberta, Canada. Something I'm trying to do differently in introducing my own scholarship and connecting that to land acknowledgements is to really think about the reciprocal relationships that sustain my scholarship. So I just want to acknowledge the collectives that I'm a part of, where I work through the topics, the difficult topics in this paper, and where we share support, and that just to sort of acknowledge that these communities really sustain me in my work. And thank you to Shelley. I'll reiterate what August said about it being a highlight of the year. It's really an exciting conference to be a part of. So I am a white woman with some black glasses, some shoulder-length brown hair, and a tealy blue sweater with a bunch of books in the background. I have a handout of my paper available so you can follow along or read it if I don't make it to the end. You can go to kristinrodier.com. It's right on the landing page as a downloadable file. You can follow along there. So this paper contains difficult descriptions of fat phobia, and it discusses sexual violence and racialized violence at times. And it also touches on police brutality. So please know that it covers difficult topics. This is a work in progress, part of a longer journal article, and I'll frame that as I go. So there is significant writing about challenging, restrictive, patriarchal norms through the agential and intentional performance of an unruly fat woman. However, feminist philosophers have argued that this theory of agency reinscribes an individualistic, masculinist, Western-centric, and value-laden neoliberal ideals of hypervigilance and self-monitoring. This paper is situated within these theories in terms of offering resources for thinking about experiences of resisting oppression differently to undermine the ways in which oppression individualizes and responsabilizes oppressed subjects. So, dominant accounts of agency filter into feminist theories of resistance to oppression and resistance to fat lib and fat in fat liberation. Samantha Murray argues the politics of refusal in fat liberation politics sort of privilege the deliberate subversion of norms. And feminist approaches to fat oppression focus more narrowly on the incorporation of fat within hegemonic beauty, normative health, and other structures. So Murray suggests, and I agree, that theories of resistance should cultivate embodied possibilities for challenging oppressive norms alongside structural and community-based resistance practices. So this is why I turn to critical phenomenology to center that embodied subject of oppression, who is both enacting and resisting hegemonic meanings and structures. So fat-bodied experience is kind of the heterogeneous entry point for my critical phenomenology. And specifically, I'm describing and exploring embodied possibilities for resistance to hegemonic fatphobic disgust, aiming to build worlds of possibility where fat bodies are more easily humanized and, importantly, confined with each other, sustaining pockets of collective value. So narrowing in specifically on the embodied possibilities of spatiality, I develop a description of some of the ways in which hegemonic disgust shapes fat-bodied experiences. This is developed in tandem with the question of how we might embody new possibilities, especially in the face of violent reprisal and victim reversibility. So the longer version of this paper draws on Kristin Negus's notion of fat arrivals. So this is where you arrive kind of gut first and out of line, drawing on Sarah Ahmed's queer phenomenology. These sort of gutsy arrivals offer an opportunity to bust through straight lines, challenging how our world is oriented around slender bodies. Then I discuss twirling and cartwheeling fat bodies through the example of Chris Farley. The paper gets all kinds of places. But I take that as an example of challenging able-bodied entrances, slender entrances, where you have controlled straight limbs with an upright posture where the mind governs the body. I then outline the tension with resistance of overperforming spatial expansions, such as gutsy arrivals and cartwheels, since they are made possible through a flexible spatial allowance licensed by white innocence, so overexpanding our spatiality. The section of the paper I go over today is the phenomenological groundwork, describing fatphobic encounters, constructing experiences of forced spatial expansion, and how that leads to victim reversals. So contextualizing this in a larger system of dehumanization and violence against fat people, especially racialized fat people. Critical phenomenology is fruitful for interrogating disgust reactions because it prompts us to reflect on our intentional relationship with meaning, noticing the background to our experiences, connecting that to larger social systems of domination. Socially constructed disgust reactions offer a starting point for this method, since, as Michelle Marr writes, quote, disgust is not a condition of an object. It is an effect of a beholder's intentional relation with an object. By paying heed to disgust as a gut reaction, an opportunity arises to interrogate the ethical implications of a cultural system that regularly establishes boundaries between different types of bodies, rendering some beautiful, some acceptable, and others disgusting. So what's this about? This is about the idea that we shouldn't just sort of push down our disgust reactions. We actually need to bring them out and give ourselves time to think about what they mean and what they do. Following Lisa Gunther's method, critical phenomenology method, slowing down these reactions, noticing them, offers moments to suspend their meaning, shift attention, and think about the relationship among the elements. So the following descriptions slow down some of the aspects of fatphobic disgust, describe and reveal relationships amongst those meanings, illuminating a specifically spatial element of fatphobia. So it's not the only critical phenomenology that can be done of this, but it's one. In describing what it's like to encounter and enact hegemonic disgust, we can get a sense of whether there are possibilities to recover spontaneous meaning that might create and sustain worlds of liberatory possibilities. So when I call up something like resistance to fat phobia, I just want to differentiate a specific politics that starts from collective embodied possibilities. So I'm not centering moves like banning diet talk or grappling with thin privilege checklists, though please do that work if you want to. I'm not sort of thinking about how, you know, moralizing arguments stigmatizing fatness are irrational. Sort of in my framework, this is like the difference between reading a book and going to therapy. I'm not focusing on built environments and how they don't fit many our and many other bodies, though this is part of a larger structure of, you know, reinforcing disgust. I'm trying to think more like, because that might make it seem like if I'm talking about spatiality, I'm talking specifically about how environments are built, but I'm thinking more about lived possibilities for space. So they're related, but I'm coming from the subject's position. So I'm drawing on Merleau-Ponty's notion of the bodily schema that mediates the world for my lived body, the body as it is for me in the first person, opening a unique range of possible actions and points of sensitivity in the world. So another way to put this is that the lived body is that which tacitly produces the totality of my possibilities and sensitivities in the world, defining my sense of lived space rather than objective space that one might measure from the outside. So I'm investigating fat phobia as a way of inhabiting the world, not as solely ideas in our minds or structures outside the self. One aspect of this is an embodied direction, a felt direction as a result of our engagements. We can investigate these orientations through how our bodies create and express these spatial meanings. There are not universal predetermined experiences, but rather variable patterns of meaning related to social location and experiences. It would be highly unusual, however, if a fat person had not encountered some of these experiences at one point or another. So I guess what I'm trying to say is this is not an essence, this is not universal, but these are common things that, you know, vary. And if someone hadn't experienced something like this, chances are they're not inhabiting a fat body, it's something else. But not only fat people experience hegemonic disgust, that should be given. So the experiences of taking up too much space, being larger than the expected or valued body. But it's not just that, it's about being perceived as taking up more space than we actually do. In the presence of fatness, we experience bodies that are recoiling, moving out of the way, making motions to bend over and puke, avoid, give an overly wide berth. This is a very common experience. Not only do people move further out of our way than necessary, they are overcome also with staring, turning, and taking extra looks, usually in ways we can totally see. Fat people are filmed in public without our consent, made fun of behind our backs, to our sides, and to our faces, and made into memeable content. When we move, there is a kind of sense of reverberations going throughout our body that others are avoiding. And it's like they take it up, mocking our walks, adding sound effects, words are shouted out of car windows. Sound is very integral for this, about policing and constructing space. Disgust reactions, puking noises, animal noises, gasping, very large gasping noises, and noises of shock. So while people tell us what happens behind our back, most often these actions are completely easy to notice and done right in front of us. If they are moving into our peripheral or a gray zone, there's often a kind of ambiguity they can play with. Oh, that wasn't about you, or I didn't say anything. And if you actually push and say, no, that what I know what happened, there's usually extreme anger in response. So it's like you don't know what you know. So these experiences build a kind of overall feeling of having provoked something. Doing nothing is doing something. Our clothedness is a type of nakedness. So there's a lot of times where fat people are wearing clothes, but they're just showing a lot of skin, and they're reported as nudity on all kinds of different social media filters. We are not exposed. We have exposed the other to us. Our presence is assaultive. For example, not eating in public, we are eating while fat in public. Our dancing also threatens spatial boundaries, because beyond our physical borders. People run from us at the pool shouting, my eyes, my eyes. We've landed the first blow, fatphobic violence in response is self-defense. So consider Tanya Tichkovsky's phenomenology and what it reveals about the relationship between staring and blindness. Ableist automatic reactions to blindness in the non-blind person reveal those embodied anxieties and intercorporeal meaning that underlie the taken for grantedness of visual consciousness. Tichkovsky details a near universal response from people when noticing a blind person, which is to stare, to avoid, to go silent, and to slink away. Staring specifically takes on meaning in relation to blindness since it surfaces an automatic, ambiguous realization of vision, staring into that which does not stare back. She also discusses slinking silence that reveals cultural maps of blindness as a lack of knowledge. Oh, they won't see me do this. And they won't see what's happening around them. Blindness is also an excessive disruption leading to one's, this is her quote, leading to one's return to normal life. Blindness as the inability and or poverty leading to they don't have anything to offer, unquote. So the meaning of blindness is that it is an unknowing that one can avoid through silently slinking and moving away. So that's the meaning that arises by investigating the embodied habits. This explains, among other things, why reactions to bodies vary between different spaces, but they also develop patterns of meaning. So the meanings of fatness are revealed in the recoiling, the overly wide berth, in the bending over to puke, the animal noises, and so on. What we learn in this study is that merely arriving is fat arriving, which is to say, it's a kind of busting into the habit body of the other. These elicited bodily habits reveal a physical spatial rejection and a move away. And it contains ambiguous meaning because it's both the forcing out of a contagion, a fear of consumption, and then a kind of animalization. At the same time, providing these intense feelings of safety, right? And amusement. And it's just kind of an interesting mix. The lived body, of course, is not, by contrast, the size of our physical outline. I've kind of talked about this already. But to describe their extension into space through embodied possibilities are at once rejected. So we don't want you going here, but also hyperextended. You're assaulting me. How much and how one embodies space enforces and constructs power differentials, which is why understanding resistance in these encounters must proceed carefully. So what lines of resistance are open? So these encounters with disgust must be understood within a larger system of dehumanization and white supremacy. In Sabrina Strings's book, Fearing the Black Body, The Racial Origins of Fat Phobia, she details how 18th and 19th century European philosophers and scientists on race used racial categories to justify slavery and define white feminine aesthetics as morally and genetically superior. Fat black bodies were isolated amongst the lowest form of embodiment because of a presumed inborn propensity towards laziness, gluttony, and dull minds that were overly occupied by digestion. You see this over and over again in the literature, overly occupied by digestion. So it's like you can't think because you're eating. It's like it's co-defined. These sciences argued that also that hotter climates increased propensity for weight gain, despite at the time the voluptuous and plump feminine ideal in elite European culture. That didn't matter. Specific patterns, appearances, and shapes of fat tissues were isolated as proof of degenerative attributes that classified blackness as morally and genetically inferior. These racial theorists described fat as accumulated liquid under the skin. And if they observed African women who were slender, they argued that their fat was sort of just like latent. And they claimed that they had fat pockets lurking under their skin, but white people didn't have those. So Strings details these origins of racialized fat phobia to demonstrate how both fat denigration is racialized, and she isolates a concurrent construction of a pro-thin ideal for elite white Christian womanhood. This predates the handing over of anti-fatness to medical apparatus in the early 20th century. In this way, according to Strings, race is acting as a double agent. It entails the synchronized repression of savage blackness, this is a quote, and the generation of disciplined whiteness. So how and where fat is on bodies is a technique to express these repressions and disciplines. Thus, we can read embodied fat phobia as a reverberation of these social distinctions between bodies. So one area of resisting disgust reactions is in feminist art practices, some of which interrogate disgust in the subject, and some of which interrogate disgust in the viewer, or some both. Haley Morris Cafiero's work, Weight Watchers, displays public, and it's weight, W-A-I-T, watchers, Weight Watchers, displays public reactions to her fat white body from a hidden camera. She captures a lot of these sort of embodied recoil and amusement reactions to her body on camera, and invasive staring and so on, from a lot of different people, but primarily slender white women. This direction of disgust tells us about social hierarchies and how they're enacted. Morris Cafiero's project highlights specifically these embodied revulsion actions from fat at fat feminine bodies as a constitutive and reinforcing pillar of fat phobia, demonstrating limits on feminist critiques of, let's say, restrictive patriarchal beauty standards, since the lived reality of fat bodies reveals they're not coded as fragile or in need of protection. And this is shown of even less value, expanding these white beauty standards for fat Black women and others, as the idea of fragility and femininity kind of don't go together. These deviations from normative femininity produce illegibility, such as fat victims of sexual assault. As I've argued elsewhere, fat victims of assault are considered sort of physically unrapeable. They're big enough to take care of themselves in various ways. I sort of unpack that in a few ways in my work, as well as kind of, you know, unrapeable due to being always open for business and so on. So sexual, verbal, and physical assault continue to be justified against fat people as their bodies are objectified, cut up, degendered, reduced to the status of objects or animals. Morris Cafiero's project brings into visual focus the unchallenged and ubiquitous disgust reactions of those encountering her body. The camera captures the faces of disgust, which at the same time capture enjoyment. The disgust reaction is unselfconscious to its own capture. Morris Cafiero inhabits a kind of virtual subject position through the camera, which acts as a proxy or a stand-in to reduce harm. She's kind of expanded herself out of the harmful encounter at the moment. Similarly, Cindy Baker, a fat white artist, has used doubles or appeared in absent ways in art spaces to highlight what makes them difficult to enter. In addition to guarding against the violence of the encounter, this strategy allows Morris Cafiero to share actually the experiences to legitimize their reality. A legitimization that caused enormous violent pushback. As a resistance to hegemonic disgust, this technique is divorced from the temporality of the encounter and triangulates the virtual gaze of another. So I think it's an interesting form of resistance. In a similar light, the meaning of fatness is revealed in the way the bodily habits are elicited by fat arrivals. So here, perhaps we can make better sense of Chris Farley's choice to cartwheel into certain spaces. So the longer version of the paper kind of describes how he would arrive by cartwheel. His arrival was already an amusing busting through of straight lines, living and enacting a forcibly extended schema. Unable to bring it back to his body, he challenged the lingering of disgust through chaotic bodily flinging, provoking surprise. And so I'm kind of arguing that using surprise is one way of kind of interrupting disgust. He challenged this force extension through deliberately performing it. I think it's interesting too, because it resists uprightness, and deliberately performing a hyperextension or deliberately performing with a stigma and exaggerating it is kind of a common way of negotiating a stigma. However, his particular form of resistance works with white masculine social privilege and reiterates a kind of whitely ontological expansiveness. This is drawing on Shannon Sullivan. Farley and other white fat people who double down on spatial extensions as resistance do not do so without risk, because it's accessing a kind of non-threatening childlike fatness that's licensed by whiteness. So the idea being, he's reinforcing that. So cartwheels, gutsy arrivals, and other forms of deliberate fat arriving need to pay attention to the strengthening of white habits of expansiveness and risk displacing hegemonic disgust elsewhere, strengthening potential embodied recoil. So these hyperextensions play into how fat people are, in some contexts, considered unvictimizable and always already to blame in a situation. This is affirmed through symbolic representations, which you're probably all familiar with, of evil and unintelligent characters as fat, symbolically demonstrating their lack of fitness for moral life and their bad character and so on. Unvictimizability is also upheld through how violence to fat bodies is downplayed, diminished, and often played for laughs. Anna Mollo details how state-sanctioned violence against fat Black victims weaponizes not only fat phobia, but ableism. Racist justifications are upheld, but also in the case of fat Black victims, their fatness is constructed as a disease they were already sick and dying from. So many high-profile cases of victims of police brutality were diminished because the victims were fat and or disabled, right? There's different ways that causal loop gets going. This coexists with the idea of forced spatial expansion, since these killings were in part justified by the idea that the victims were dying anyway, but that they were also larger and more aggressive and older than they actually were. So it allows those things to coexist together, even though they contradict each other. In Deshaun Harrison's work, Belly of the Beast, The Politics of Anti-Fatness as Anti-Blackness, which I highly recommend, he explains how fat Black masculine bodies are perceived as animalistic and aggressive, echoing eugenic justifications, but also making a spatial point that these bodies are constructed always already as bigger than they are. Something strengthened and enforced through hegemonic disgust reactions, enforcing normatively slender whiteness. Something similar is operating when fatness is used to consider Black children's bodies as much older than they are. I think like Tamir Rice, this was a big part of, you know, his case where he was, I'm not feeling good, 12 or 14, but then considered to be an overpowering adult. It just makes no sense. And they quoted his weight in the articles about it. It was just really awful. So because they're bigger than they are, they're also morally culpable, charged as adults, and so on. In these instances of forced spatial expansion, the doing nothing carries being both so big, powerful, and threatening, but also this idea that one is sick and near death. So this dual justification for violence only works in retrospect, because the person was too sick to be killed. Again, it doesn't sort of work. The spatial expansion projected onto fat intentionality is itself the origin of the imagined threat. So I think that's kind of the crux of the paper. I'm going to say it again. The spatial expansion projected onto facial and fat intentionality is itself the origin of the imagined threat and the justification for forms of violence, including those which are state sanctioned and so on, sexual violence. So this is the victim reversibility. I'm on my last page. So we're doing nothing is always already having done something. Fat provokes the violence against it. Thus, the site of resistance Yeah, I just want to make sure I didn't miss a page. The site of resistance needs to focus on the fat phobic embodied habit of spatial recoil in the first place, because it constructs this hyperextension. It both provokes violence and precludes protection of the person in the encounter. To return to Strings's work, this violence explicitly tracks how body fat is shaped, but it is also tracks how bodies move. What kinds of are they upright? Are they slender? Do they conform to straight lines? Meaning within social categories is developed according to how and where and which body parts stick out, jiggle, move, which parts are bigger than others. So in her book, Bad Fat Black Girl, which I also highly recommend, Cecily Bauer describes the gendered racialized fat phobia she experiences and how it is specifically complicated by what she calls being built bad, which she unpacks as meaning, among other things, she goes into detail that her fat shape is not an hourglass. Now, this affects her position in embodied hierarchies also. So it's beyond a kind of like racial identity. It goes to the shape. This affects her position in embodied hierarchies, she argues, because it removes her from certain forms of masculine protection, subjecting her to increased, you know, this violence. And she goes into detail about that. Not only is protection removed, but also in the case of sexual violence, enforced spatial expansion is the justification for victim reversibility, since fat women are big enough to take care of themselves, but also always actually the aggressor. So for anything to have happened, they would have been the aggressor. So here's my conclusion. So actually, well, I can talk about this in the Q&A. There's a documentary that talks about making victims of assault into kind of the criminals. So this is my conclusion. There is an affective risk in my paper, and it's been brought up to me in a few different presentations, in centering these fat phobic harms and violence. I'm aware it risks reinforcing narratives about fat people's lives as tragically ruined and overdetermined by pain and harm. However, I feel there's cause to stick with these difficult feelings. One reason for this is to resist the move to body positivity. Like, I've literally been asked in a question period, like, can you talk about fat joy? I just feel like, and I'm working with Harrison here. Harrison talks about how this is kind of thinness rerouted. It's a kind of co-opting of fat people's collective liberation by imploring that they just love themselves more. And I have a really hard time with that. Harrison argues that resistance to fat phobia is so often structured through a white desirability politics, and he's got desire / ability there, right? They're put together politics. And thus fat bodies, especially those that are deformed, disfigured, unsightly, and built bad, do not have access to claims to humanity. So this critical phenomenology has highlighted the ways in which fat phobic encounters skew bodily schemas, violently enforcing an animation of one's intentional extension into space. Since we are often moving between different spaces constructed through intersectionally variable fat phobias, it's open, I think, how we can differently resist disgust. But I've just kind of put out some examples of resisting this spatial expansion, but I don't have a recommendation in the end. I don't think it should be mandated. Theories of fat resistance, such as those mentioned in the introduction, must center the experiences of racialized fat phobia, lest they prop up the false notion, which I think is a really damaging notion, that Black people don't experience fat phobia. It's just a really weird thing that gets recirculated in body positivity spaces. It's really, really harmful. This demonstrates the moral imperative to undermine the fat phobic habits in the first place, highlight what they're doing, to really outline the forced spatial expansions that dehumanize fat people and justify violence done to them, holding a mirror up to and I'm borrowing Sabrina Strings's words here, a pro-thin ableist white supremacy. So that's the end of my talk.
Thank you very much. Just want to say thanks for a very insightful talk. I learned a lot. We do have one question in the queue so far. This comes from Hypatia of Sva. In this topic and other political discussions, the term disgust is used to describe a system of oppression. How do you distinguish this kind of disgust from other intuitions, e.g. against smells, sounds, visual impulses being generated from overwhelming sensible situations? Or is this form of intuitive disgust not actually the topic here? And is it more about the reaction as a violent action on its own right that is different from retreating from a situation for an overwhelming smell?
Yeah, so I'm drawing on a bunch of literature in the paper, if you wanted to check it out, which is sort of looking at, I think one of the main theorists here would be, I don't have it, but the Michelle Marr piece, The Feminist Aesthetics of Disgust, it talks about Mary Douglas and contamination and social contamination. And so I would be making a pretty strong distinction in the paper between a kind of hegemonic disgust, so that which is used to reinforce social and bodily hierarchies, and maybe, like, I don't know if you're having like an evolutionary theory of disgust, or it's like really bad if we eat rotten food or something. And so I'm really talking more about sort of socially constructed disgust, how it's used as a tool of oppression. And that those would be separable, right? There's no, in my view, reason to be disgusted at a lot of bodies that we have socially discussed about.
Great. Thanks. Again, please, if you have questions, put them in the Q&A. If there are no more in the Q&A, I will take the opportunity to ask a question myself. So I wanted to invite you to maybe say something. When I think about fat arrivals, I can't not think about some of the auditory and sound related things that go on. So I'm thinking about like heavy breathing. And in particular, near the very end of your talk, while you were talking about sort of the juxtaposition of markers of like illness or sickness, but also like threateningness. And I think there might be something here too with the heavy breathing that kind of signifies that tension here too. So anyway, I just wanted to invite you to maybe say something about some of the sound things.
Well, that's interesting. When you were talking about sounds and fat arrivals, I thought for sure you were, because I'm really trying to look at it as a dyad, like an encounter.
Yeah.
And so I'm thinking about the ways that sound is used to like enforce those hegemonic disgusts. So, but I wasn't thinking about fat arrivals as making sounds. I mean, it's ambiguous, right? Because like, I probably do have a heavier step than other people, but when people make sounds that go with my step, you know, to mock or whatever, my arrival, it's kind of like, that's no justification for it. You know what I'm saying? So like the heavy breathing for me, I haven't thought about it from that position. I was only working on fat arrivals in terms of like the shape of expected bodies. But they're both connected in terms of like signifying a kind of illness in a way that needs to be sort of forced out. I can't remember what writer was writing about fatness and academic spaces. I think it's in a different it's in this one paper I cite in my contribution to the Bloomsbury Guide, where they sort of talk about academic spaces and like how terribly inaccessible our buildings are, but yet we're expected to like just, okay, we're everyone's leaving with the speaker and we're all walking together up four flights of stairs together. And some of us are dying off on the side and we're just supposed to hide that. And the person who's writing the paper is saying, as a thin person, even that is a very challenging task for me too, but I'm implored to cover that up because it's my body is not, it, my embodiment is not welcome in this kind of way. I can't remember where that citation is, but yeah, is that kind of what you were moving towards?
Yes, definitely. And the reason I wanted to talk about it too is that it's sort of puzzling to me because I, as a fat person, I feel that there is a reaction of disgust to my heavy breathing, but it's not, I don't know what that's situated in. Like, I'm not hearing a response. Maybe it's part of the silence as the, because, you know, you're talking about the relationality of the response, but I'm not, yes, it's really fascinating. Anyway.
I have experiences of like, I'm going upstairs in public, you know, whether that's like in a river valley or a subway or whatever, and people will be like, good for you.
Yeah.
You know, so it always, yes, has this dual like amusement, childlikeness, lower than, but then also the revulsion is the back door of it. And so it's like, it's ambiguous.
Definitely. There is one more question in the queue now. This comes from Luana Adriano Araujo, who writes, thank you for this. Maybe this will be out of topic, but I was just wondering if this socially conditioned disgust is in some way related to the notion of abjection and abject bodies in Butler. Are they in tune somehow?
Yeah. So I was kind of coming out of literature that is not making a big distinction between the kind of theory of disgust, because I'm working more with kind of like what the body wants to do. But that's definitely there. I really, really recommend Michelle Marr's work on feminist aesthetics of disgust, because if you're interested specifically in questions around fatness, like there's lots of theory out there, you know, read whatever. But the article deals with a problem that I have definitely taken a position on, which is whether we should try to hide that which we're disgusted about, or if we should surface it to deal with it. And so she talks about the work of Jenny Saville. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Jenny Saville's work. She really draws these extraordinarily large canvases, draws. I'm not an art person. Big canvases of her fat body from really, you know, obscuring angles, ways that are kind of about provoking disgust. And she gets asked in an interview, why do you hate women? Why would you portray them like that? And, you know, that to me is the thing that animates this question of whether we bring disgust up to deal with it, or if we push it down as a kind of, I don't know, ignore it and it'll go away move. I don't think it's going to go away by ignoring it, by painting pretty, you know, Dove campaign for beauty type bodies. So yeah, abjection is part of that too.
There is one final question, and you may not have much time to answer this, but luckily I think you just hinted towards some point that may be relevant. I'll at least ask the question, which comes from Ness. Thinking about art and photography as a site of resistance in terms of centering and creating more art that reflects aesthetic beauty and fatness, not as a novelty and not eroticized. I wish more photographers and artists were attuned to Dr. Rodier's points about ableism and fat phobia in Western aesthetic preferences for things like slender, erect postures in art and media.
Cool. I'm working with different kinds of art. So the visual, taking pictures of the recoil, but also like performance art. And I just think it's really interesting how we can use that to kind of construct these kinds of phenomenological experiments in a way, and see what arises from them to tell us more about what that underlying embodied habits and meanings are. Yeah, that's why I'm working closely with Cindy Baker. We've worked on like fat suits, feminist art practices that use fat suits for feminist reasons. So there's like a peeling off of and liberating through the fat suits. We've been working on those. I think it's a really, really tough representational project.
Great. Well, thank you so much. I think that just about wraps up this session. Let's all just give our thanks for this excellent talk. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for your attention.